Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for tuning in this afternoon for this special weekly webinar discussion about leading in turbulent times. This is part of our now weekly series looking at doing business in the age of coronavirus. This webinar is presented by Smith Business Insight and by Queen's Executive Education. My name is Meredith Dalt, and I'm a business journalist at Smith School of Business at Queen's University in Kingston, Ontario. Before I introduce today's speaker, I do want to remind you that this discussion will be recorded and you will be receiving a link to that recording by email in a couple of days. If you want to ask a question, and we hope that you will, I do want to remind you to use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. The Q&A button is the best way to get a question into the discussion, and we'll be opening the floor for questions in the last 15 minutes of today's discussion. It's now my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Julian Barling. Dr. Barling is a professor of organizational behavior at Smith School of Business, where he also holds the Borden Chair of Leadership. He is an authority on transformational leadership and was recently named as one of the 10 most influential leadership researchers in the world. He's also a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada and holds a Queen's Research Chair. Dr. Barling has received numerous awards for his teaching and research. He has also authored more than 200 articles and 14 books. Thank you, Julian, so much for being with us today. I'm going to give you the floor, turn my own mic off and my own camera off, and let you have at it. I'll talk to you in 45 or so.
Thank you very much, Meredith, and welcome, everybody. Before I begin with the actual presentation of the slides, what I'd like to do is just thank everybody for taking the time to join us this afternoon. What I'm going to do this afternoon, hopefully in about the first 45 minutes of the hour that we have together, is talk about five topics. Spend a little bit of time just thinking about the situation of whom are we leading right now and what are their needs. Then talk about transformational leadership during a crisis. After that, we can spend a little bit of time talking about leading in a sense in the new future, and what is the personal leadership challenge for us as we move forward. I'm certainly planning that at the end of all of that, there will be time for questions and answers. So if we can move to the next slide, the very first thing we need to do is to understand the challenges faced by the people we're leading. And in order to show this, what I'd like to do is to start off with some polling questions. Sorry, we'll get to that in a minute. What I'd like to do is to use the well-known Maslow hierarchy of needs to metaphorically demonstrate where many people are in terms of their psychological needs right now. If Maslow is indeed correct, we spend most of our lives doing whatever we can to ascend the hierarchy. And Maslow was always explicit, it's a long-term endeavor. And for many people, we don't even reach the top of the hierarchy. And then along comes the coronavirus in 2020. And what we see is something that was shown in research at the beginning of the 1970s. And that is that when people's needs that they had formerly satisfied are no longer satisfied, they metaphorically slide down to the earliest levels of the hierarchy. And the person depicted on this picture is in between the physiological and safety and security needs. And I think that is an accurate depiction of what motivates most people now. Self-esteem, belongingness may be less important when we're worrying about our health, significantly about our health, about our financial well-being. And for many of the people who've been laid off, this is a very serious, real daily challenge. Another way of appreciating the enormity of what people, the people that we lead might be experiencing, is to turn to actual research. These are the results from a study published in the Journal of the American Medical Association. It's a study of 1,257 healthcare workers in 34 different hospitals in China. And the data were collected between January the 29th and February the 3rd. And what these data do is compare primary care and secondary care providers who worked in Wuhan, in the Hubei province, but not in the city of Wuhan, and then people who worked outside of the Hubei province, but inside China. And across various different dimensions, depression, anxiety, insomnia, and a measure of what would typically be referred to as post-traumatic stress disorders, what we see is that the healthcare workers employed in Wuhan are now experiencing clinically significant levels of depression, anxiety, of mental health issues. So even for the people who've retained their employment, mental health will be a significant issue for us to appreciate. If we can just do a few polling questions, I'm going to ask you a question, if you can respond when the screen is appropriate, and then I'll show you how your results, the results of the current group, compare with some national data from Canada. So the first question is whether you can rate the extent to which you agree or disagree with the question, the COVID-19 pandemic is the most serious challenge Canada has faced in the past 50 years. If you can just indicate whether you agree, neither agree nor disagree, and so forth. And we'll just wait a few more seconds for some more people to have an opportunity to respond. And if we can move to the next slide to show you your results. So what we can see just from the group attending today, 88% of people would agree that this is the most serious challenge Canada's faced in the last 50 years. I'll get back to an interpretation of this in a moment. If we can just take a look at the Canadian data on this. Sorry, if we can, apologies, if you need to, if you can just close the little box that was appearing there, you'll be able to see the results. What we can see from a Canada-wide sample of well over 2,000 people who were interviewed at the end of March, about 73% of Canadians would agree and say that this is the most significant challenge. And this was done about 2 weeks ago. So if the group in present today are representative, then that the number of people may have gone up. The second question would be, would you say that the COVID-19 pandemic is less serious, more serious, or about the same as the SARS outbreak of 2003 or the September the 11th attacks of 2001? And if you can just respond to this. And if we can just take a look at the Canadian data, and you may need to close that pop-up window in your screen. And if we can just look at the Canadian data. So I'm not sure if you can see the Canadian data, but what we'll see is, again, it's about 77% and 71%, but in the group in attendance today, the numbers were even higher than that. For the next question, I don't have any Canadian data for comparison purposes, but the question would be, would you say the COVID-19 pandemic is less serious, more serious, or about the same as the financial crisis in 2008? And just wait one or two more seconds. And if we look at those data, it's about 85% would say that it's more serious. And collectively, the question then is, how are people experiencing the stress, and how does this relate to leadership? And in a sense, that's going to be the topic for today. How are our leaders functioning in this environment? Here's a poll that was done in Canada about just over a week ago. And I'm not going to comment too much on this poll, particularly right now. But what we're going to do is, in a sense, look at the leadership of people like Francois Legault and the provincial leaders, as well as Justin Trudeau and so forth, and just look at their approval ratings, particularly Francois Legault. And the question that we will get to at the end of the webinar is, what is it that they're doing that is inspiring such approval and confidence across the Canadian landscape? So how does this relate to leadership? So people are experiencing this pandemic, by and large, overwhelmingly, as the most significant stressor that they've experienced in their lives. And how does leadership play into a context such as this? I think the first thing to appreciate is that Bernie Bass, a wonderful researcher and commentator on leadership, made the point many years ago that during times of crisis and uncertainty, people become charisma hungry. So right now, you may well be leading many, many people who are hungry for charismatic leadership. A second point to emphasize before we continue is that we know from research that during times of crisis and uncertainty, the effects of leadership become magnified. And that's a stable finding. But what we should point out is that what it really means is that the effects of good leadership become magnified. And at the same time, the effects of bad leadership become magnified as well. So with that as background, what is the goal of leadership? I think the goal of leadership is to elevate your followers. And in particular, elevating your followers, picking them up, becomes most important in their worst possible times, which is, we've seen for many people, would be what they may be experiencing right now. The problem is that in trying to think about what leadership is required right now, is that most leaders overthink the solution. And they overthink the solution in as much as they believe that extraordinary problems must surely call for the most extraordinary leadership behaviors. And what we know from research is that this may not actually be correct. Even during normal times, the challenge is not what is the most enormous things you can do, sometimes to get the smallest possible changes. The challenge really is, what are the smallest possible things that you can do to make a meaningful difference in other people's lives in their worst possible moments? And with that as background, I think we can move into the nature of transformational leadership and how transformational leadership and charismatic leadership would manifest at times like this. So remembering at all times that the aim of transformation is to elevate your followers, and that there are four components to transformational leadership, or four behaviors in transformational leadership. The first is idealized influence. And a much better name for idealized influence would simply be ethical leadership. And in times of crisis, as we're experiencing now, I think that the comment by Elliot Ackerman on the right of the screen, who was a military leader in Afghanistan, is now a writer. Elliot Ackerman, in a recent New York Times article, says that steely honesty in the face of grim facts is, in a sense, the height of ethical leadership. And I think that that's what it means right now. And it's steely honesty. Steely honesty combined with realistic hope, not unrealistic hope, but realistic hope. And it is an honesty which is transparent. So why is transparency so important now? It is very difficult to trust what we cannot see. And this becomes even more important during a crisis. We need, not just for our leaders to be behaving with integrity, we need to be able to see our leaders behave with integrity. Our leaders need to show up in the most personal possible way. And given the crisis, it does not mean that they need to, in a sense, be with us, but what is the most personal possible way that they can be with us? A wonderful contrast of this would be between Jacinda Ardern and Boris Johnson. In one of the earliest and most important public comments, public meetings of both of these leaders. Jacinda Ardern appeared before the cameras, made a very short and clear set of comments, and then spent the overwhelming majority of the time simply answering questions. Boris Johnson's major public early appearance was pre-recorded and played in a way that did not allow for any kind of questions. And I think the question that we need to confront ourselves with is, what is the most plausible way that we can present ourselves before people at a time like this? Doug Ford, and I will comment on Doug Ford's leadership in a little while. One of the comments that grabbed me earlier on was how Doug Ford didn't just say things. He jumped into his truck and delivered a donated shipment of ventilator masks himself. And he's done that more than once since. So the best of integrity is not just about what you say, but what example can you set? An example that goes all the way back to 9/11 came from Don Carty, who was chair and CEO of American Airlines on the day of the attacks on 9/11. And a few days afterwards announced that American Airlines would have to lay off 20,000 people. But he immediately, and in the same comment, announced that he would forego all his compensation until the rest of 2001. So what are the simplest ways in which you can show your integrity is the challenge from an ethical leadership perspective. I think we're seeing quite a few examples of leaders being willing to take the same kinds of pay cuts that they may be asking their employees. But at the same time, we also have to point out that not in Canada, but in the United States, there are some concerns that senators, congresspeople may have used the information that they obtained through confidential briefings to better themselves financially. Remember that at times like this, the effects of leadership are magnified. So the best of leadership, the effects are magnified, but that's equally true if the worst of leadership is displayed. So something I've learned working with leaders that I think should be very encouraging, especially in times of a crisis, and that is that your employees will not hold you accountable for what you could not do. But they will hold you accountable for what you could have done, but chose not to do. And going forward, they're going to remember and reward you in the future for doing what you did not have to do, but did. So what are the smallest things you could be doing right now that will make an enormous difference in people's lives? And I'll return to this theme several times. But for example, many leaders are in a situation where they've had to lay off people, not because their work was insufficient and so forth, through no fault of their own. And many of these people who've been laid off will be part of the workforce of the future. And as we'll see later, part of your challenge will be how to motivate them. So what are the smallest things you could do right now? Could you reach out to them and find out how they're doing and so forth? It's the things that you don't have to do, but you do because you choose to, that will mark you as a leader that they want to work for going forward. So one final comment to end the notion of ethical leadership is simply that if integrity is your guiding principle, your behaviors will always be consistent. And toward the end of the webinar, I'm going to talk about the importance of consistency. But it's a consistency, you'll see, that is born out of your integrity. It's a consistency that is born out of your ideals and your beliefs. The second component of transformational leadership is inspirational. It's being inspirational, but especially right now during times of crises. It's giving people a purpose for doing whatever they need to do. And a really good example of this comes from Jacinda Ardern. We see signs all over reminding us to stay home, but stay home is simply an order. Every single time Jacinda Ardern uses the term stay home, she says, stay home and save lives. So it's you do what you do, and then we give people a purpose for doing it. And in a sense, what we do is, when we do that, is we bring people together. We bind people together and we lift them up, we elevate them. And we show people just how much they can achieve, just how much they can help their communities through small acts during these times of crises. So the standards are high. We're asking people to help save each other's lives, but we convince people that they can do it. During normal times, inspirational motivation is invariably about firing people up. It's about charging people up. It's about getting people excited about their work. And I think inspirational motivation, the nature of inspirational motivation, changes during crises. During crises, it's the best of inspiration is often about calming people down in the midst of a storm. And what I'd like to do is show you a short video clip from one of the greatest political speeches of all time. It was a speech given by Robert Kennedy shortly after he heard that Martin Luther King had been assassinated. Just to give you a little bit of a backdrop on this, Kennedy was campaigning in Indianapolis. And when the police and the authorities heard that Martin Luther King had been assassinated, they asked Kennedy, they advised Kennedy not to give a speech because they were terrified that there would be racial rioting after his speech. Kennedy does not take their suggestions and he goes to deliver the speech. The speech was prepared while Kennedy was in transit from the hotel to the place where the speech was given. He prepared it himself and delivered the speech. I'll show you a short snippet. On the back of a flatbed truck. So if we can just watch this snippet, please.
I have some very sad news for all of you, and I think sad news for all of our fellow citizens and people who love peace all over the world. And that is that Martin Luther King was shot and was killed tonight in Memphis, Tennessee. Martin Luther King dedicated his life to love and to justice between fellow human beings. He died in the cause of that effort. In this difficult day, in this difficult time for the United States, it's perhaps well to ask what kind of a nation we are and what direction we want to move in. For those of you who are black, considering the evidence evidently is that there were white people who were responsible, you can be filled with bitterness and with hatred and a desire for revenge. We can move in that direction as a country, in greater polarization, black people amongst blacks and white amongst whites, filled with hatred toward one another. Or we can make an effort, as Martin Luther King did, to understand and to comprehend and replace that violence, that stain of bloodshed that is spread across our land, with an effort to understand and compassion and love. For those of you who are black and are tempted to be filled with hatred and mistrust of the injustice of such an act against all white people, I would only say that I can also feel in my own heart the same kind of feeling. I had a member of my family killed, but he was killed by a white man. But we have to make an effort in the United States. We have to make an effort to understand, to get beyond or go beyond these rather difficult times. What we need in the United States is not division. What we need in the United States is not hatred. What we need in the United States is not violence and lawlessness, but is love and wisdom and compassion toward one another. Feeling of justice toward those who still suffer within our country, whether they be white or whether they be black.
So if I can just make a couple of comments about that video, and I have to confess, scholars have analyzed it in much better detail than I'm gonna convey right now. But I think some of the hallmarks is, at their worst possible moment, what Kennedy was doing was inspiring people to be better than they believed that they could be. What Kennedy was doing was bringing people together around a common cause and explaining just how much they could achieve. And the way he did it is really important. Never raised his voice. He was truly calm. And one of the factors that I'm always struck by when I listen to the speech is the use of pauses. How every now and then he just stops and there's silence and he carries on. And inspirational motivation during people's worst moments, I think, is very much about bringing them down, about creating a sense of calm. The third aspect of transformational leadership is what is referred to as intellectual stimulation. And this is not about intellectually stimulating leaders. This is about how can leaders help people think more so that they can be, in a sense, part of the solution. During times of crisis, confusion typically reigns, and in a sense, I think reigns in two ways. It rains down and it reigns supreme. And it's during this confusion that what we really need to do is to help people think about problems in innovative ways, help people think for themselves, because we cannot do their thinking for them. And in a sense, our challenge is how can we get people to see, to understand this new reality? And I believe it's all about clarity. It's all about taking whatever the message is, and it's about clarity, and as we've seen before, consistency and calm, and we'll get back to that. But two examples, one comes from FDR during his fireside chats during the Great Depression. And Schlesinger, a presidential historian, says that what FDR tried to do was take what was a very complicated subject and make everybody understand it. And the people responded, finding Roosevelt deeply and personally responsive to their troubles. He never tried to appear brilliant or anything like that. He saw his challenge as bringing the problem down to, in a sense, its simplest common denominator, its simplest level, where people could easily grab onto what the challenge was. A comment about Barack Obama and clarity. For many leaders, you'll go back, wonderful, famous leaders who, in a sense, we all know about today. Churchill would be an example. You can go back and you'll find that his early school teachers, in their school reports, commented that what they had was a child who had the potential for wonderful leadership. So these are very interesting statements. It's always easy after somebody's a leader to say we always knew it. But Barack Obama is also somebody who was predicted to be a leader before he actually got into any position like that. When Barack Obama was still a law student at Harvard, one of his fellow classmates boldly said that she predicted that Barack Obama would be president of the United States one day. And when she was asked why, her response was, she'd never come across anybody, anybody who could take complicated material like Obama could, and make it seem so simple to everybody else. So what we need right now are leaders who can do that. Leaders who can boil down what is almost not understandable into things that we can all bind around and material that we can all understand. I would say that the fourth aspect, and sometimes the most puzzling aspect in some ways, of transformation leadership is what's referred to as individualized consideration. A perhaps better term for that might be relational leadership. And relational leadership is always important, but it might become especially important during times of crisis. And what do we mean by relational leadership? We're talking about compassion. We're talking about empathy, which becomes especially important during times of crisis. Again, Schlesinger commenting on Roosevelt. He said that Roosevelt dictated his Depression-era radio addresses while trying to visualize the individuals he was seeking to help. A mason at work on a new building, a girl behind a counter, a man repairing an automobile, a farmer in his field. What he was trying to do to be able to communicate with them was putting himself in their shoes to be able to understand how they were experiencing the adversity and the hardship. So it's about being able to get out of yourself and be able to experience what they're experiencing. It's about empathy, it's about listening, it's about compassion. And I find that this component of transformational leadership is one of the most puzzling, because I don't think it's you'll find a situation in which leaders don't know that relational leadership is not of primary importance. And yet when you do surveys, what you'll often find is it's relational leadership that is sort of missing. So why? Why is it that people, leaders, shy away from expressions of compassion and so forth? Well, the one is that they feel they don't have enough time, but I think that's true during regular times and so forth. A second, and there's some intriguing research about this, which may really help during a crisis, is it's not that leaders don't know that this is important, but rather leaders undervalue the effects of gratitude and compassion on other people. We don't truly appreciate just how much behaving in this way would mean to others. And this particular, one particular research project shows that we significantly underestimate how positive small expressions of compassion, gratitude, and so forth would make others feel. And at the same time, we overestimate how awkward it might make them feel. We think that if we stop people and, in a sense, thank them, congratulate them, acknowledge them, and so forth, that it would leave them almost squirming. My comeback on that is, no, I think it'll probably, in most cases, but especially in times of crisis, leave them glowing. What are the smallest things you can do to help people feel that what they're doing is critical and important and so forth? It's not the big stuff, it's the small stuff. We also significantly underestimate how surprised they will be for what we're grateful for what we thank them for, and so forth. Why is this study important? Because when they showed leaders, in a sense, how much other people appreciate their gratitude and their compassion and so forth, leaders started to behave more in that way. They started to show more gratitude and empathy. So put yourself in their shoes right now. Just appreciate how important this could be for them. And my guess is you'll be on the right track in terms of knowing what it is that they want and need from you right now. A small example of a big act of gratitude that I think meant a lot to a lot more people than just the recipient of what you're about to watch. If we can just watch this video clip, please.
Another shout out that I want to do that doesn't get very much recognition at all, but it shows up every single day to help with sign language is Christopher behind me. And Christopher, do you have a minute for just to come up here for 1 minute? I apologize, you can take over the sign language. But this gentleman shows up, never complains, never says a word. And I told him today how many comments and emails and phone calls I get about you. My friend, you're a champion, you're a rock star, helping people in the deaf community. And it's so important the role you're playing. And I was told today that moving forward, you're no longer gonna be with us physically here, but you'll be with us as a team. Is that right?
Yes.
So again, think about, you will be rewarded for what you didn't have to do, but you chose to do. And certainly Premier Ford did not have to do that. He chose to do it. He acknowledged not just that person, and signing is a very difficult physical activity. You get tired and so forth. People don't sign for too long, then somebody else takes over. I think the deaf community probably felt truly acknowledged. What are the smallest things you can do that you really don't have to do, but that is going to make a huge difference, will generate more respect for you moving forward. So moving from transformation leadership and into just some speculation about what might the future look like, and leading into this new future, a question that's being asked over and over again is, when do we think the pandemic crisis will be over? And I think there's going to be two levels of an answer. The first is, well, we're definitely looking towards our public health authorities to tell us when the pandemic crisis is over. But from a psychological perspective, there's another kind of answer, which I think is going to be instructive in how we lead going forward. And what we know from psychological research and theorizing is that crises of the magnitude that the pandemic are over, crises of the magnitude of the pandemic are only over when people feel that it's no longer a crisis for them personally. So there will come a time where, in a sense, where the pandemic may be declared over, when people can go back to work. But we cannot assume that all the people who hopefully will be coming back to work at that stage just feel that the crisis is over. They may feel that they may still be living in that crisis. So what will the future look like? I think that there's two responses to this. There's sort of a work perspective, and then there's an employee perspective. And from the future of work perspective, this is really difficult. I don't think any of us can truly predict what the future of work will look like, how much it'll change, in which directions it will change. But an early attempt at trying to understand, I think technical innovation is going to take place at a pace that we've not seen before. Just think about the number of people using Zoom and engaging in remote work. The principal of Queen's made an incredibly insightful comment. He said that if 6 weeks ago, you were trying to get the entire university system in Canada to move from in-person classes to online classes, it would have taken 10 years with committee meetings and so forth, and we did it in a week. I think that's the new normal for organizations. Work from home, physical distance at work, cultural shifts. So a cultural shift that means something, that seems small but means something big. I saw a report this morning that Dr. Fauci suggests that we may need as a society to simply stop shaking hands. Yet that's been such an expression in some situations of trust, for example, at the end of negotiations. And I think we're going to see from businesses and from people increased demands on all levels of government at precisely the time where they're going through significant periods of austerity. At the personal level, I think that what we're going to see is very much what we saw at the beginning of this webinar. We're going to see rampant financial insecurity, even for people who are working, remain working, or get their jobs back. Will they be repaid at the same salary? Are their jobs secure? I think people are going to be reverting, if you take a Maslow metaphor, to those early safety and security needs that in the previous era, post-2008, had been satisfied for many people. They're going to be the need for belongingness. So if we're no longer all working together and in close proximity, workers always satisfied our needs for belongingness. There's going to be a real challenge. Workers always satisfied, been a way that we can possibly satisfy our needs for self-esteem, but there are going to be many people who are off work. So psychologically, I think that we will be leading people who have a different set of psychological needs. In trying to understand how we can meet those needs and so forth, let me just pose the question of what if two things do these three leaders have in common? So Francois Legault, Doug Ford, and Andrew Cuomo. And the first is, I think that 6 to 8 weeks ago, if I would have said to you that in 6 weeks' time, these three leaders will have historically high, for them, approval ratings, you probably would have laughed me out the room. If I would have told you that Francois Legault's leadership approval ratings would be 95% and higher than most political opinion polls have recorded, well, since they've been done in the time of FDR or Harry Truman, I think you would have laughed me out the room. Francois Legault's approval ratings of 95% are actually higher than George H. Bush during the first Iraq war, or George H.W. Bush immediately after the attacks of 9/11, and those were the highest of any US president ever. So the question then is, what are they doing that is attracting this kind of approval ratings? And I think that what they have in common is they're doing four things. They're expressing a compassion that is born out of integrity. They're showing calm, they're role modeling calm in the midst of a societal storm. They're conveying and creating clarity in what is the most confusing times of many of our lives. And they're showing compassion, as we saw the video clip with Premier Ford. In a sense, what they're doing are the smallest possible things that just overwhelm other people with their kindness. So the leadership challenge right now is we're leading people who are going to be stressed, uncertain, anxious. We may have had to lay people off, sending them into an uncertain future, which creates questions for many of the people that do that. You're probably going to be leading in an environment for which you've had very little preparation. If we take our graduates from our school, from any school, be they undergrads, MBA grads, exec ed grads, and so forth. These are people who for the last many, many years have been trained to lead during times of expansion. They've been trained to lead during times of growth. And now they're thrown into something for which they're untrained, unprepared, and so forth. And that is really stressful. They may have been ill themselves. They may have had family members who were ill, or even worse. And we know that there is something that we refer to as the emotional toll of high quality leadership. That the more you try and do whatever you can do for a leader, the more it depletes you personally. So in closing, what I'd like to do is offer two thoughts. So moving forward, if you're gonna try anything, leadership behaviors, different leadership behaviors, or any actions, subject yourself in a sense to this question. So before you do anything, just ask yourself, is what I'm about to do likely to convey and create trust or signify distrust and destroy trust and respect among people? And if you think what you're about to do is likely to convey trust and respect and so forth, you're on the right track. But if you question that for yourself, take a deep breath, give yourself another opportunity, and you can do it. I'd like to end with a metaphor that was actually given to me by one of our graduate students, Leanne Keck. So it's the oxygen mask metaphor. If you've traveled a lot, you know this well. What they tell you on a plane is, if anything goes wrong, put your mask on before helping anybody else. And the idea here is, if you're not in a fit physical state, you will not be able to help anybody else. So as we come to the formal end of today's webinar, look after yourselves. It's not selfish. Look after yourselves because you deserve it, but look after yourselves because if you have the strength, you will be in a better position to be able to look after everybody around you. So take care and stay healthy and stay safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Julian. Lots to think about there and some very inspiring final words. We've had lots of questions. I hope we'll be able to get to all of them, but here we go. I'm going to throw some things at you. They're all over the map. The first question that has come up many times, will our audience members be able to get copies of your slide deck? I have
shown
everyone. Yes?
Sure.
What's the best way? I don't know if everybody out there wants the slides. I mean, I guess we'll have to figure out a way to get slides to the public, to the audience.
Sure.
Okay, so we'll take care of that. I'm assuming there'll be a way with your email addresses that we can get the slides out to the audience. Thank you. That's very generous, Julian. Thank you. Sure. A question from a union leader in Alberta who writes, I'm wondering how you balance keeping your membership informed without overwhelming them. They get lots of information from the media, social networks, etc. So how do you make any message you give relevant without seeming like you're simply talking to hear your own voice?
Thank you for the question. And you're right, this is in a sense, unions historically have been seen as groups of people who are in competition or opposition or whatever to management. But I don't think that that's an appropriate view of unions. I think the best view of unions is that unions provide a collective voice, and the purpose or goal of that voice is to support management when they do wonderful things and to be in opposition to management when the unions are concerned that perhaps they're going off track. Now is a wonderful time, if you believe that management are doing the right thing, to be willing to support them. The best example of this right now of two groups that have in the short term historical sense, have not necessarily cooperated that well would be the federal Liberal government and the Ontario Conservative government. The relationship between them right now, the cooperation between them right now is extraordinary. So cooperate when you should. If you believe that they're doing things that cooperate when you should, help when you should. And comment from earlier, if you do what you don't have to right now, but do choose to do the right thing, the company will remember that going forward. If you believe that they're on the wrong track, let them know. And I'm purposely saying, let them know. If necessary, speak to your members, but you don't have to repeat everything the company says if you agree with the company.
Okay, so that's how you don't overwhelm them, by just sort of only speaking when you have to.
Yes, speak when you have something constructive to add.
Okay, wonderful. Oh my gosh, the questions are coming in. Goodness. All right, audience, I will get to you when I can. Another question. I sense a strong desire for many people I'm in contact with working at all levels and of the organizations and businesses to just get back to normal as soon as a green light is given. Uncertainty leads us to seek familiar and comfortable territory, no matter what the reality says. So it's an understandable reaction. So this person writes, an already overused phrase, the new normal, seems to be what we're headed toward, though, certainly for the short to medium term and possibly for the long term. As we proceed toward whatever lies in the distance, what are some key factors I should be focusing on to help my people and myself guard against the fear of operating in new ways?
In a sense, that's a question that is always relevant, but of course it's especially relevant right now. How important is this? Well, most universities offer whole courses on change management. And those courses are offered in a framework where the management leading the change typically know where they're going. And as the person who submitted the question is alluding to, of course, even managers right now are leading change, but they don't really know where they're going beyond a very short-term window.
Okay.
And what that requires is in the first instance, an openness from management themselves and a strength. And you're going to get that strength by looking after yourself. It sounds almost too preachy for words, but you really have to get your sleep, and you have to get your nutrition, you have to get your exercise and so forth. You have to put yourself in a position where you can have the strength to lead others. And then I think when you lead others, remember that they're as uncertain as you are. They're as uncertain as you are. And I think that what we've learned now is from a leadership perspective. I want to talk from strategizing exactly what the future will look like. But in terms of helping people get there, I think the key elements are going to be consistency and calm and clarity and compassion. And anything you can do to heighten that and acknowledge to people, you know they're fearful and it's not going away anytime soon. That's the new normal. The new normal is not the period post all of this. The new normal is this.
Okay. Thank you. Speaking of leadership styles, and you talked earlier about Canadian leaders being charisma. You talked about the Canadian people being charisma hungry. The question is, are people in fact charisma hungry, or are they competence hungry when it comes to leadership right now?
So when we think about leadership, when I think about leadership, I do something that may be unfair, but I almost take competence as a given. And I think that most of our leaders have the basic competence. It is, in a sense, the leadership skills on top of the competence that is often what goes first during crises. And what we revert to is just call them the hard skills. So in crises, we often revert to what we know best, which is just getting the hard skills right. And we build up a deficit, if you will, an invisible deficit in terms of the soft skills. But it's the soft skills that are going to motivate people to try and go more, to go almost beyond themselves, to be willing to push themselves to levels that go outside of their fear zone and so forth. So it's not that competence is unimportant. It's, I think, that during crisis times, people revert to what they're most comfortable with, which is their hard skills.
Okay. All right. You also talked earlier about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Will people rebound and go back up the hierarchy of needs, asks one of our audience members.
Sure. And I'm using Maslow's hierarchy as a metaphor just to describe how people are responding. The best answer in terms of Maslow would be it depends. And it really depends how their personal circumstances enable them and how quickly their circumstances enable them to re-satisfy those needs which are now challenged. So if our need for safety, and that includes physical safety and physical health, if 8 weeks ago, 12 weeks ago, we could just take that for granted, but we no longer can. At a point, Maslow would have said, at a point where we can now take our physical health for granted, we will go up the hierarchy. So in a sense, it really all depends on the extent and the speed with which those earlier lower order needs are re-satisfied. And for many people, you can see that they will go up the hierarchy again. Unfortunately for some, it may take a lot more to go up the hierarchy again. There are reasons to be concerned. And one of the things we do know from some research in the early 70s is it takes a lot longer to go up the hierarchy than come down. So you can come down, as we've learned now again, in a matter of weeks. But Maslow always said going up takes years.
Okay. But not giving up hope would be key. One can still go back up, you're saying.
Oh, yeah.
All right, we have so many questions. Oh my goodness, and we're so close to time. So I'm going to dig into a few more that have all just come in. Here's one. A recent study conducted by Deloitte suggests that millennials would be less reassured by gestures, such as senior leaders taking a financial cutback during a time of crisis, something you mentioned earlier, because their values align with purpose, mastery, and coaching. Are workforce demographics being considered during research pertaining to decision-making? How to set an example during times of crisis?
Okay, this is a difficult question. It's a difficult question because it's a controversial question. And I wish I had more time to respond to this, but I fully appreciate that there is a lot of focus in the world of management and so forth on demographic changes, millennials, etc. Unfortunately, if you look at the very best academic research, they don't necessarily support the validity of those sharp differentiations. So, the so-called demographic profiles and so forth that we see spoken about so often don't actually, they're not validated when we do academic research. My guess is that if you just take, for example, a Maslow hierarchy as a platform for understanding, I think that virtually all of us are probably operating in terms of lower level concerns than we were before. Showing an example of gestures and so forth, I don't believe that in a sense that it's not simply a gesture, it's a role model. What you're role modeling is a value. If what you're role modeling is an ethical belief that I too should have a pay cut and so forth, I think people will respond. And I say that, let's look at it the other way around. We know from other financial crises and downturns how people respond when they see their leaders not taking a cut, when they see their leaders laying people off and in the worst scenarios, getting a pay increase and so forth. If you can extrapolate from how badly people feel and how angry people feel in the worst of times, I think we can extrapolate about how well they'll feel when they see their leaders choose to do the right things.
All right, well, that was clear. Thank you. I think we've got time for one more. This question is, should the leader give audience or team an idea about worst case scenarios and best case scenarios of the future, or should the focus be on the positive aspects only?
So I can't remember the exact quote from Elliot Ackerman at the beginning, but it's a real steely honesty. And if all we give is the best possible scenario, at a very practical level, we could well be proved wrong. But also it might well be we're just conveying an unrealistic optimism, and I don't believe that's the best of leadership. I believe that we should, in a sense, prepare people for the future. And if we give them what the best data show about the worst and the best case scenarios, what we're doing hopefully is preparing them for the worst and hopefully planning in a way that can achieve the best. So no, I think this steely honesty is not just about optimistic hope and so forth, and realistic hope.
And I suppose we're seeing our leaders doing that with these projections they're giving us with these broad numbers of potential deaths and things like that.
Yeah, and in terms of not being proved wrong, they don't want to stand up and every day have to correct themselves.
So they just give us a wide range.
Yep.
Yeah, okay. Well, we are pretty much out of time. I do want to note that one of the questions we got, which I will not let you answer because of time, is what are the practical strategies of leading teams when working remotely? Which leads me to be able to say that next week's webinar is on the topic of leading virtual teams, and we're going to hear from Dr. Jana Raver next week. So I do hope that our audience will join us next week for that presentation. I also want to remind our audience, as I always do, that Queen's Executive Education offers opportunities to pursue remote learning. This is an ideal time for that sort of thing, I would think. So for more information, you can visit smithqueens.com/execed. And learn more about the kinds of programs and learning development opportunities you could be partaking in right now. So Julian, Barling, thank you so much. I have to tell you that so many of the questions that have come in were in fact just comments of people raving about how much they love you and what a great speaker you are. Many of your former students say hello. It's really been such a pleasure listening to you today, and I'm sure that our audience has learned a lot from you. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Stay safe and healthy, everybody.
Yes, absolutely. On behalf of the Smith School of Business at Queen's, I want to thank everybody who tuned in today. And again, thank you, Julian. And I do hope that everyone will tune in next week to hear from Jana Raver on leading virtual teams. Take care, everyone.